furniture from Poland right here. Another meble z Polski, European.
Meble, like meble.
Yep, meble. Yep. Where did you get the word meble?
Hi, Ted.
Terrance.
Real nice to meet you.
Call me Terry.
Okay.
These yard sale stuff?
Yeah, we're gonna get rid of junk. We cleaned out the basement. We got a dumpster, you know, cleaned out that.
That dumpster?
Not those. Those are city. But last weekend we had a bunch of artists come in and clean up the basement. We're installing machinery down. Machinery from another world. It's gonna be fantastic.
Hope you covered that, Ted.
It's called Snafu. The Empire Snafu restoration project. We're restoring an empire, a lost empire. So it's going to be fantastic.
How much are your violins?
Oh, those are not for sale. Those are very expensive. $20,000.
That's my
turn.
This one, who's how much?
Oh, that won't be that expensive. No, it's a very good violin if you play. And, do you play?
No, I play guitar.
Okay. But it's got great sound.
Terrence, do they have, like, names down below? You know, words? Name,
yeah, actually, this one, I think, says it was restored early 19th century, which makes it probably 18th or earlier.
1870, it says.
Yeah.
Facet made.
Yeah. I don't play violin.
Try.
It sounds like a modern composition that you come up with.
Yeah, it's atonal. Now this is the library. It's where I come with a bottle of wine and a cigar at night. Read books. Full of oddities, by the way. We have an albino stag there. We have a three-horned goat. Unfortunately, he's covered in cellophane because I keep the moths out. I have over here a rampant fox. That snakeskin under him is about 18 feet long. There's Alakazam, the mechanical man. And he does tell fortunes, created by Blackstone the magician. There's a tiger's head. Over in the corner, there's a coyote. He's covered in plastic, too. So if you can't find what you're looking for in this room, it doesn't exist. That costume is Turkish, early 19th century. painting back there, again under wraps, is by one of Williamsburg's greatest artists. That's Naoki Iwakawa, represented by O.K. Harris. We own that. We're collecting a lot of art from Williamsburg artists for a collection. We're actually documenting this period of time in the greatest art community in the world. I think we're the only ones building a major collection here. It's important to do. The painting there is an English impressionist. That's Teasdale, that's right. Morton Percy Teasdale. Very important work. In the upper corner over here we have a painting by a Royal Academy artist. That's the murder of Thomas Becket. Forget the name of the artist. His son. The horse here, this carousel horse, is by Frederick Hein. Frederick Hein was one of the earliest manufacturers of carousel animals. In fact, he was the first real manufacturer of carousel animals. And this is a top-of-the-line horse. He only put this type of mirror in his top-of-the-line animals. And this horse has been seen by Sotheby's, and they say the mane is really magnificent on this animal. That's a very good Russian artist, a surrealist. A lot of the Russians are surrealists and visionary, fantastic artists. They're really magnificent and skilled.
This is a tribute to Nabokov.
A tribute to what?
Nabokov, Vladimir Nabokov, the butterflies.
Oh, yes, that's good. That's good. That's very good. Notice the spider in the middle of the butterflies, a very Victorian touch, a monster in the midst of beauty. The other painting over here on the other side, which you'll come to, is by Gorlam Deli. He's a local Williamsburg artist, a magnificent artist. He's from Venezuela, I believe. And again, we're very proud to have him in our collection. I believe he's due for great fame. He's a young fellow. If you want, I'll take you up to our treasure room.
Let me just get a few more moments of this.
Sure.
This is so wonderful. Just fantastic.
That's a soccer game.
That's a great photograph.
Yeah, it's a great photograph. And I think the Prince of Morocco has the very first image of that print.
Here is you.
That's me, yes. Deliberating. That's Yuko and myself in the treasure room upstairs.
Oh, okay.
The Lord and the Lady of the Manor. And on the other side is Yuko with, Yuko is the owner of the building, of course, and the founder of the Art Center.
Okay.
And she was getting an award as one of the state's women of the year here.
Fantastic.
Yeah. That picture down there is me.
Great.
That was a Kate Spade commercial, actually. Kate Spade, of course, is a magnificent designer of women's handbags and everything.
Okay.
And I'm playing charades there, and somebody said, do Williamsburg, so I did Williamsburg.
Let me get another glimpse of this guy.
What? If you want motion, I can turn him off.
Oh, that'd be fantastic. Yeah, and I can shoot just like that with the...
Thank you. This is actually made to resemble Akbar the Magnificent, who was a famous magician in the palace of, this is Ali Kazan, right? He's a famous magician in the palace of Akbar the Magnificent. And all of the fortunes for Akbar seem to come true, for this magician, the original magician, could conjure the warp and weft of the fates and realign them to his wish. Unfortunately, this angered the Archmage Merlin, who by a magic spell transformed Alakazam into what is now known as the Pillar of Akbar. Blackstone magician had this mechanical fortune teller made to resemble Alakazam. Much to Blackstone's amazement, the fortunes put forth by this machine were uncannily accurate. It's true.
We could ask him a question, I guess.
Yes. Now, if you notice, you can see Ali Kazam reflected to infinity on each side. That's where he reaches through time, space, to read your fortune. And I believe now he has indeed read your fortune, and I'm going to allow you to choose your fortune. Now, Joe, if you could reach in.
All right, I need that.
The fortunes are not always good, so be prepared.
I think it's going to be very fortunate. Ali Kazan states, virtue is its own reward.
Yes, and you're a virtuous man, I know that. You have a reputation. Very good. And you're happy in life. It is its own reward.
That's right.
Now we'll go up, I believe, to the treasure room, where we'll see magnificent things going back to the 15th century.
I did miss that, you're right.
I love that creaky door.
I did miss that. In fact, can you open it again, please?
No, just...
A suite of music from the month with three oranges. Sergei Prokofiev's work. Yuri Temirkanov conducted the St. Petersburg Philharmonic Orchestra on 96.
Treasure room. Many great, great historical treasures are in this room, going back to the 15th century. The furniture is actually by Pierre-Antoine Béranger. He was cabinet maker to King Charles X. The furniture dates from about 1810 and is Paris high style. The arms of the furniture are in the shape of the swan, which was Josephine's favorite style. And there's actually furniture by Bellanger in the White House and the Blue Room. But these pieces, I think, are earlier. In the corner over there, we have a statue of Mary Magdalene. It goes back to 1410. It's Flemish. It's a reliquary statue. They used to keep a relic of her garment in the back. The documents on the wall, on one side we have Joseph Bonaparte as emperor. He was a brother to Napoleon. On the other side, we have a document signed by Napoleon as emperor. And a little further on the other wall, we have Marie Louise, a document signed by his beautiful wife, with whom he had a child. So we have many historical treasures in this room. The Sèvres vase there is signed by Duprez, who is one of the greatest painters of these vases. Very valuable vase. The bronze there is French, late 18th century. It's called a brûle parfum, which means it's an incense burner. And it's as fine an example as you will see in any museum in the world. The French were masters at bronze making during the late 18th century. The English were very competitive with them, and jealous, in fact, of the French bronze makers. Over here we have a gold ground painting. That's actually, light's not very good over here, but that's a 15th century painting from obviously a church or a chapel. That's St. Paul with the sword. Very few of these paintings are in private hands anymore. They're all in museums. We have here, again, historical documents. This is the last will and testament of Dowager Lady Strathmore. And not only do I have in here her last will and testament, by the way, Dowager Lady Strathmore was the mother to the Queen Mother of England, who died in the last couple of years. And in any case, besides the marriage contract in the last will and testament, we also have the entire inventory of Glamis Castle, where the late Queen Mother was raised as a child. Very unusual to have documents like this in my collection. People ask me, where did you get it? And I always tell them, well, that's a secret. I have here the belt buckle of Dr. Arnault. Dr. Arnault was Napoleon's doctor. And this belt buckle was in Napoleon's presence on his deathbed. It's documented. We have many rare books. This is a book from the library of King Henry VIII. It's actually dedicated to King Henry. On one side, this is an impressed binding, one of the very first impressed bindings in the world, an Oxford binding. And these show the four apostles on one side. And on the other side, you can see this is King Henry's coat of arms, the Rampant Hounds. And the book has been owned by many great collectors, Baron Double, Horatio Walpole, among others, Clarence Bemis, and now, of course, it's in my collection. Actually, by being a book collector, you can become very famous down through history if you are a great collector. We just sold at auction at Sotheby's an incunabulum, which is a book printed before the year 1500, and it was a Justinian Codex, magnificent book. And that money will be used for restoring this magnificent building. Other objects in the room, nice paintings. This magnificent council down here. It's one of the most magnificent pieces I've seen. I gilded that myself. I asked Sotheby's to do it, except they were talking about, you know, pounds and pounds of gold leaf, and it would have, you know, cost a fortune to do. So in the end, I did it. Over in the corner here, we have magnificent carving of Christ. It's Italian High Renaissance. sustained some damage over the year, but still a magnificent carving. Especially if you throw the shadows up from below, you get all the magnificent sculpting. You can see a very nice job. A very sympathetic piece. Next to it is a cutting from a Book of Hours. It shows Mary and the doctors in a nice little scene there. Actually, I think cuttings from Books of Hours are the most expensive works of art in the world per ounce, so I'm told. Over here we have other things. I don't think I'll talk about that knife right here, but it has some great history of its own. It's not just an ordinary object. It belonged to certain people at a certain period of time, which is very disturbing to some people.
Can we hear about that?
You want to hear about it?
Sure do.
Okay. Okay. This knife, you know, it looks just like an ordinary Nazi knife, of course. It's not really, because not all knives are Danesine blades like this. And on one side, it says, I believe, if I'm quoting correctly, "I give my heart to Destiny, or Irene, in her destinies." On the other side is what makes the blade so unusual and identifies it. It says, "Death's Head Squad, Dachau." So this was a blade carried by the guards at Dachau prison camp, where they murdered millions of people. I don't know millions, but many people. And when the Americans and the Russians were closing in, the guards were told to throw these into wells, destroy these, because you will be immediately identified, and your crimes will be known, and you might be even murdered on the spot. So that's, in fact, what happened to most of these weapons. That makes this weapon one of the rarest weapons of its kind in the world. A remarkable reminder to a very interesting period of human history. Now that's one of Napoleon's marshals, Suchet. Probably not one of the great marshals, but still, to be a marshal in Napoleon's army. Now that's a uniform from an American soldier. It's about 1830 or 1840. The buttons identify the unit he was in. A rather small uniform makes one wonder if this was a boy, possibly, or a very small man. Maybe he was one of the drummers. On the other side, we have that's a Durer etching from his small, series of small woodcuts on the life of Christ.
Joe, move that turn, aim that a little bit down. Yeah, there we go, perfect, just right there.
I saw that this Linus, the skin was folded up and the head was out there, at the flea market on 23rd Street. Of course, I think it's illegal to buy and sell these things, but the magnificent face, the very sympathetic face of this Linus really took me. It's like something out of a fairy tale. Very appealing face. Not growling or anything, just beautiful.
It's very peaceful.
So I thought it was suitable for the room. Mm-hmm. We've had photo shoots up here many times. We had a fashion shoot up here. Yeah, that's an American portrait of a woman who was obviously a very tidy housekeeper, a very frugal keeper of the house. Some of the rarest things in this room, in fact, I very seldom show, and I'm not even really going to show you these two pieces because you'd have to, you know, put them in proper light, but
right.
These are pieces of stained glass, English Gothic, mid-15th century. Some of the rarest stained glass in the world. Because of the Reformation, much of the stained glass was destroyed by, you know, the reformists, and so that these survive is really remarkable. These are listed with the Metropolitan Museum of Art because they're so rare, and the Metropolitan wants to know where every other rarest of the stained glass is. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, that's a plaster bust by Emily Abbey Dunn, and she's a 19th century woman artist who worked under Hiram Powers, among other great artists. This is actually the plaster for the bronze that was eventually cast. Very nice piece, a Mohawk Indian. A New York Indian by a New York artist. The reason I acquired that book, because it is French. I guess it's 18th century. I thought it was at first the book belonging to Marie Antoinette because of the M-A that's, you know, on the outside of the book, but an expert tells me that's not true.
Latin's in large in the French.
See any more wonders?
Absolutely.
You do?
Absolutely, yes. Everything that you will reveal.
Yeah, this is a very nice book. This is a Shahnameh, which is a Persian book of kings. And this book, it actually, the Shahnameh is partly fiction, partly true about the kings of Persia, like Saddam Hussein. And it contains actually 18 illuminated paintings, really magnificent little paintings, and done about the year 1508, I believe, is inscribed in the colophon, and which would make it about the same time Leonardo da Vinci was painting his Mona Lisa, this book was made. And so there are 18 beautiful pictures, usually of people being murdered. Here you see somebody with his head hacked off and his body cut in two, among other things. I guess the Persian king is going right up to our present time with Saddam Hussein. We're pretty brutal characters. Let's see if we can find some other pictures. That character there is Rustum. He's a famous, fabulous character from mythology. You can identify him because he's wearing this certain type of hat, which is some sort of a leopard, I guess, a leopard cap. And here he's defeating one of his enemies. Here's another one. You can see there's a lot of murder and mayhem. Again, they're torturing this poor fellow. They took off his head headpiece, and now they're cutting away his scalp or something. Dreadful. But I don't think the Persians were the only, you know, brutal people, as you can tell by that knife I just showed you recently. Here again, another picture. Again, somebody's being beaten down. A couple of horns blowing in the background. Just beautiful. God. This book was actually restored so that these paintings had actually fallen through the original paper because of the acid used in the lines and the ink. So this was restored probably in India by Indians. but they didn't understand Persian, so many of the folios are out of order. I showed this actually to an expert. Is that wood before? And he said that this particular part here was the most magnificent work in the book. Anyway, it's a beautiful book. That's the binding. Probably a more of an Indian manner, as you can see, rather than a Persian manner. So this cover is actually 20th century, probably. So I do have a number of very unusual things. These are trial proofs, and trial proofs for a medallion in this case. And this was, the designer of this is a royal metal maker to actually three kings of France. This is a very long-lived metal maker. I forget what his name was. But in any case, what's very nice about this must have been actually handled by the designer and maker of the metal, the royal metal maker. Because, you know, he would examine to see if it's just the way he wanted. This is actually handled by the guy who made it. Very unusual. I also have, these are called splashers, again, a trial proof. They're made in lead. This is one for Napoleon. And I have another one, again, for one of the great men of France, late 18th century. I have a number of little medals in here. Another splasher. Very unusual. People usually don't collect these lead splashers, or they're hard to find because they threw them away, actually. So it's very unusual to have those. Anyway, that kind of completes a small tour.
Fantastic.
Of the treasure.
Thank you. Okay. Some more every time I come here.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff here. There's things I could show you.
I figured the last time I ever been here, I'm going to make it sick.
So I'll wait till you guys go out, and then I'll turn off the lights.
Terrence, is there any way to get to that the loft up there?
Yeah, would you like to?
Because there's this magnificent window I noticed from the photograph I took of the building.
Actually,
it's boarded up.
You can, and the roof is really magnificent. The view of the skyline and everything.
That'd be great.
Okay,
great.
Let me go down and lock the first floor up.
Mm-hmm.
And then we'll
Cool.
Dinner party. It's a little party of ghosts up here. They're having tea.
Oh yeah, those guys. Look at this, Virgin Mary's.
Yeah. Now that's the runway. We have ghost model shows here. Thank you. having a hard time with the economy.
There's another staircase, Jesus.
Okay, I don't know if anybody wants to go up.
I don't bring my camera.
Okay.
Want me to get a public camera as you go on?
That's right. I'm gonna, let me see here.
I think everything is all right.
Everything is all right.
I think everything is cooking up to the something really, really nice and outstanding.
I'd like to ask you, what's your whole plans for this this upcoming surrealism show?
Well, the whole idea is to get the best and the brightest of the surrealist, visionary, fantastic artists in the world, have them all convene in one spot in the emerging art capital of the world, the largest art community in the world, that's Williamsburg, Brooklyn. And we're going to show the world what these people are all about. The New York City art world, you know, is all 1960s postmodernism. And even the museums like the Metropolitan, the Guggenheim, think that surrealism is dead. When in fact, the single largest art movement of our time is surreal, visionary, fantastic art. We have a huge movement. It's a very quiet movement. It hasn't been talked about. So we're going to show the world what that's all about. It's like a huge convention, not really an art exhibit. We have H.R. Giger, very famous artist. Ernst Fuchs is flying here from Vienna. He's the founder of the school of Viennese fantastic realism in the 1940s, a contemporary of Salvador Dali. This is going to be the greatest show that Williamsburg ever saw, with a fantastic surrealist costume ball. Nobody will have ever seen anything like this before. Fantastic.
Well, you know, I was wondering if this is the hunt or anything that I decided.
ends that wall.
You choose what you want.
Okay, great, yeah. Great. And you know, this is not disruption for you because no one will have artwork on the wall.
Yeah.
So, you know, of course we put the little to not step it. It is steppable, mm-hmm. You know, I made it yeah. that you can walk on it, but mm-hmm. I don't want to create like people, you know, standing jumping on it. You know, just have a impression
foot.
That okay. they experiencing the real water.
So we're going to have, in this room here, we have Madame Dog. Very sexually dressed, who will be escorting visitors from up here down to the show, down to the category for the standing room.
The sexy
outfit. Yeah, actually, we just cleaned it out, and being built, it's not going to be installed until, you know, late August.
What had this building been?
Well, the Kings County Savings Bank building, uh-huh. built in 1867. As I said, it's in the National Register of Historic Places, and the seventh building in all of New York City to be landmarked, a very important structure. And the style of the building is French Second Empire. The outside is Dorchester sandstone. It would not be possible to build a building like this today, simply not possible. And it's strategically located, you know, Manhattan's right across the bridge here, good subway stops. It was easy for artists to come and live here when the area was run down because you had a lot of empty factory spaces and rent was so cheap. It was a dangerous neighborhood too. But since the artists moved in now, the neighborhood is now safe. You can run around at night. It's probably safer than any other part of the city. And you have over 60 galleries and a lot of international restaurants. So it's great for tourists too, as well as the artists, everybody. Fantastic. Focusing on a work of art like yours, it takes tremendous focus, integrity, hard work, determination, all of it's the intelligence. And you cannot do great things unless you have it all together. That's why I am a killer. I follow great people. That's what I do.
Muscles.
problems on the building. Just working with some engineers on that.